Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It's delightful to see so many happy and smiling faces. It's good to be among friends. This doesn't feel like a book launch or anything. It feels like a Lunar New Year reunion dinner of sorts. But it's a good feeling. It's infectious. A warm welcome to the global launch of Dr. Mochtar Riady's autobiography, My Life Story. It is a privilege to be here today, to be in the company of Pak Mochtar, his family, among friends and longtime associates. It's my honor now to invite Mr. Brian Riady, Director Lippo Group, to tell us a few words about his grandfather. Brian.
Speaker of Parliament of Singapore and our guest of honor, Dr. Halimah Yacob, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. Good afternoon. My name is Brian Riady, and on behalf of my grandfather, Dr. Mochtar Riady, and our entire Riady family, I'd like to welcome you to this afternoon's celebration, the book launch of Dr. Mochtar Riady's autobiography, My Life Story. Thank you. This is a very special and joyous occasion for our family, and particularly for my grandfather, Pak Mochtar. And we are extremely grateful that so many of you could make it here today to honor my grandfather's life story. We have a short program for you this afternoon, consisting of a lineup of esteemed and distinguished speakers, as well as a dialogue with my grandfather, Dr. Mochtar Riady. We hope that the session today would be enriching and would be a blessing to you all. At this point in time, I would like to invite our six VIPs to take the stage. First, Speaker of Parliament of Singapore, and our guest of honor, Dr. Halimah Yacob. Deputy Chairman of the Lippo Group, Professor Dr. Ginanjar Kartasasmita. The Chairman of Kerry Logistics, and former Singapore Foreign Minister, Mr. George Yeo. The Dean of the Lee Kuan Yew School of Public Policy at NUS, Professor Kishore Mabubani. The Dean of the NUS Business School, Professor Bernard Young. And of course, finally, the founder and chairman of Lippo Group and my grandfather, Dr. Mochtar Riady. So at this time, it gives me great honor to introduce our first speaker of today, Mr. George Yeo. Mr. Yeo is someone who needs no introduction, as he is well known both in Singapore as well as abroad. Mr. Yeo currently serves as the chairman of Kerry Logistics. From 1988 to 2011, Mr. Yeo served for 23 years in the Singapore government as Minister of State for Finance, then as Minister for Information and the Arts, Health, Trade and Industry, and Foreign Affairs. Mr. Yeo is also the Chancellor of Nalanda University and chairs its International Advisory Panel. He is also a member of the Vatican Council and the Foundation Board for the World Economic Forum. And so without further ado, I would like to invite Mr. Yeo to deliver the opening speech. Thank you.
I've been asked to speak while sitting down. It is Pak Mochtar, it is such a great honor for me to be asked to introduce your book. Pak Mochtar is a great man. A Muslim friend of mine once told me that Prophet Muhammad once said that a man's life is to be measured by three things: by his offsprings, by the material things he leaves behind, and by his ideas. And on all three measures, Pak Mochtar measures abundantly. He is a great man. His book is full of wisdom. He dedicates it to three persons who shape his life and influence him profoundly. First, his father, Li Yamei. Then to his teacher, Loy Tien. And then to his wife, Li Mei. He is a highly methodical man, Pak Mochtar. And there is a deep reason why the book is dedicated to these three persons. To his father, because his father was not only a father to him, but also a mother to him, because his mother had died in childbirth when he was still very young. They had gone back to Henghua, near Fuzhou, because his grandfather was not well. And for the first 6 years of his life, he lived there very close to his grandmother. That part of him from his father is deep programming. His sense of being Henghua, for example, comes out throughout the book. His grandmother told him, "You must leave in order to come back. You must leave in order to come back to do things for the people here." Years later, he honored that commitment by building a power station in Meizhouan, a desolate peninsula, but which would improve the condition of the people living in the community, which was his ancestral community. His father taught him many things. Today at the Lee Kuan Yew School, where I'm a visiting scholar, every day I see his beautiful calligraphy. Xiao Kai, Da Kai, the father drilled him. Father exposed him to the popular novels like Sang Guo, and they introduced him to the classics. He's raised in the Confucianist tradition by his father. And then to his teacher, really his primary school principal, Loy Tien, he shaped him politically, exposing him to many things. Once, there were anti-Chinese riots. And he taught Pak Mochtar, "Don't see this in racial terms. It's a result of class divisions, of social tensions. So express in a particular way. Look beyond that." Again and again in the book, the advice of the principal comes out, including when, in his fascination with banking, he asks his principal, "What is banking?" And the principal explained it to him, feeding the hopes, the little flames of a young man. But the most charming account is about how he won over his wife. His wife saved him, literally. He was studying in Nanjing, then the Civil War broke out. He managed to escape to Hong Kong. And because of the principal law teaching him about social justice, Sambing Zui, he became of the left. He wanted to go to Yan'an to see what is Yan'an. And already booked a seat in a ship to take him to Tianjin, I think. But the love of his life, Li Mei, had already gone back to Indonesia waiting for him. And as it turned out, her letter appeared saying, I'm waiting for you. So at the last moment, he decided not to go to Yunnan. And that ship was sunk, and everyone on board died. So the wife saved him. But not just him. It was the wife, Li Mei, who kept the family together. There's an anecdote about how, because they're all Li, so there was taboos on both sides. And he had to ask the wife's mother to agree. That anecdote, you must read for yourself in the book, because it is delicious. Once he came back, someone had given him 4 gold bars. He was quite excited, not having seen gold bars before. The wife said, please, return them. You do not want to be obligated. Which was also the advice his father had given him. And then he had another part in the book where he said, any member of the family who did not grow up straight, the wife would wear them down until they became straight. So, without his father, without his teacher, without his wife, there is no life story to talk about. And that's why the book is so dedicated. The book talks about his various business ventures. And as a study in management, he reduces great complexities to great simplicities. There's a chapter when he moved in to take over Bank Central Asia. And his business principles can be reduced to 3 things. One is you need an archival system. The first thing he did was to clean up the records and to find out what's happening. Then he mastered accounting system. Because without that, we do not know what's happening. And I think anyone studying accounting should first read his view of accounting, because he says it is not dry bones, numbers, figures. It is a minefield of information about a company. In the accounts, you can find out everything. And his third principle is, and he's obsessed with it, and you can see in the way he's crafted the book and structured it, is in analyzing the workflow. Analyzing the workflow, the work process. For him, whether it is in shipping, in banking, in properties, in nanotechnology, in biology, in globalization, analyze the workflows. Find out what's happening. Find out in what's happening opportunities for yourself. So these 3 things, archival systems, accounting systems, and workflows. He talks about leadership. And he's gone through ups and downs. There's in him, deep inside, and you can see throughout his book, 3 wellsprings, deep anchors, which make him what he is. His Chinese-ness, his sense of being Henghua, being educated in the Confucianist tradition and in the Taoist tradition. A sense of China, of obligation to his origins, to people who've helped him in the course of his life. That Chineseness, without that Chineseness in him, you can't explain Pak Mokhtar Riady. Then there is his sense of being Indonesia, because he is anak Indonesia, born in Batu, outside Malang, where even till today his parents are buried. A deep sense of obligation. He talks about how in Malang, he converted a cemetery into a memorial park. A beautiful thing. Despite initial local opposition, this sense of being from East Java, from being off Indonesia. It's profound in him. And he was involved in the idea of Indonesia from a young age. His sense of revulsion against Dutch colonialism. Then, during the revolution, supporting the local commander from Malang, Commander Imam Sukarto, who later became a general, doing reconnaissance, supplying stuff to the little units, taking great risks as a teenage revolutionary. And then his life as a reflection of the ups and downs of the Indonesian revolution, of Indonesian nationalism, through the Sukarno era, the Suharto era, and the post-Suharto era, to the world that we have today. You know, Pak Mochtar is most comfortable when he's in a batik, not when he's in a suit and tie. That's him as an Indonesian, being Chinese, being Indonesian, and being Christian. I did not know that it was James and the other children who converted him to Christianity. I thought it was the other way around until I read the book. And initially, it was just to please them, as he said, to keep family relations together. So he attended classes. Then he had to go for surgery. And then he got baptized. And in his methodical way, first the archives, then the accounting system, and then the workflows, he went deep into Christianity. And he said, in my entire family, we keep together because we're all Christians. He's very proud of it. And you cannot explain him without that Christian side of him. Before the Asian financial crisis, James invited me to Karawaci, me and my wife. And I was quite surprised how the hospital was called Siloam and how they did not hide their Christian beliefs. But it was not a narrow Christian belief. He's not a narrow Chinese chauvinist. He's not a narrow Indonesian nationalist. He's not a bigoted Christian. In all his deep beliefs, he has a big heart. And because he has a big heart, there's no contradiction for him being Chinese, being Indonesian, being Christian. In fact, they all reinforce one another. And this is the story of the new Indonesia, of an embracing Indonesia, which is cooperating with China along One Belt, One Road, which is now a key anchor in the Asian century. This book is a book about many things. It's a reflection of periods of history. And it is the story of a man who has gone through a lot, who floated with the tide, and whose greatness is, out of all this, to create the three things I talked about earlier. A wonderful family, a business empire which sees its principal responsibility in stewardship and in philanthropy. Pelita Harapan, light and hope always. Universitas Pelita Harapan, Sekolah Pelita Harapan. And in being responsible to the people who work within, in being responsible to a larger community, to people in Malang, to people in Tsinghua, in Penghua, to the people of Indonesia, to the people wherever the company operates. It's a book full of treasures, full of insights, and I invite everyone here profit from them. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Giorgio, for those very warm remarks. May I invite now Mr. John Riady on stage to share a little bit more about some insights on his grandfather. John.
Thank you. Mr. Yeo, thank you for your extraordinary remarks. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, your excellencies, every grandson grows up with a certain image of his grandfather deeply imprinted into his mind. It is that image, when you close your eyes, that image comes into your imagination. It is that one image that captures the diversity and the richness of one's personality and passions and excitement. For me, that image of my grandfather, Pa Mokhtar, is the image of myself walking into his room, and there he is, seated on his study, with his back towards me, pen in one hand, books on his desk, with the most neatly written Mandarin characters that unfortunately I don't read. And there he is, thinking about the future. In that one image is a man of discipline, is a man of principle, is a man of dedication, and probably most of all, a man of the future. Those of us here who are fortunate enough to know my grandfather know that Pa Mokhtar is not interested in the past. Pa Mokhtar is a man at 87 years old who continues to look towards the future. He is excited about the future, enthused, tickled, enchanted, and he's always looking into the future. But it is this part of Pa Mokhtar that I think makes this event today here and the book launch particularly meaningful. Because this book is a rare moment when Pa Mokhtar actually pauses and reflects on the past. Growing up with Pa Mokhtar, I never hear a lot of his past. He doesn't enjoy talking about his past. He doesn't bask in the past. He's always looking towards the future. So it is in this book that actually I also learn so much about my grandfather. Not only is he a man of the future, but his future orientedness is very much rooted in the values of his past. And the ability to straddle the past and the future is maybe what makes Pa Mokhtar the man he is today. This book is a combination of about a year's time when Pa Mokhtar would take out a few hours each morning and would write and would reflect on his past and put together a story that is my life story that you have in front of you today. So with that in mind, please join me in turning our attention to a short introductory video that we prepared that hopefully will give you a bit more color on the book that we have come here today to celebrate.
This is the story of a man and of two countries. This is a story of faith and of family. This is a story of extraordinary times and an extraordinary man. This is a story of a legacy of ideas. This is the story penned by the hand of one of Asia's most successful businessmen. This is My Life Story by Mokhtar Riady.
If you read that book, you will also come to realize that that image of the man on his study, studying, working, looking into the future, is an incomplete story of Pa Mokhtar. Because as much as Pa Mokhtar is that, Pa Mokhtar is also a man of family. What I should also tell you is that as he's on that table, the moment he realizes that somebody else is in the room, in a second he'd put down everything that he's doing. He'd take you to his living room and he would engage you. He'd engage you, he'd talk to you for hours sometimes. And so Mochtar is that. He's not only a man of the future and a man of business, but also a man of family. But Mochtar is also not only a man who believes in the innate power and creativity of the individual, as he himself embodies. He is also a man of community and partnerships. And throughout his 87-year journey, he has worked with many people in partnership to build what he has built today. So I'm pleased to introduce the next speaker, Bapak Ginanjar Kartasasmita. Bapak Ginanjar is one of Indonesia's most senior statesmen, former Speaker of the House, Minister of Mines, Chairman of the Investment Board, Head of the Planning Agency, an Air Force man, many more. But he is someone who we are very proud that he is now serving also as Deputy Chairman of the Lippo Group. Please join me in welcoming Bapak Ginanjar.
Thank you, John. Pak Mochtar, Ibu Mochtar, anak-anak, cucu-cucu, distinguished speakers, panels, excellencies, honorable guests. Well, I have to start with an apology. I was just being informed to have this honor to sit here and make a comment on Pak Mochtar and the book about 10 minutes ago. Of course, it is an honor for me to be able to be invited to sit here. And as mentioned by John, I've been almost all my life in the public service. And until a year ago, when I was invited by Pak Mochtar, James, and family to join Lippo Group. It's, of course, for me, a new experience. I know nothing. I'm always on the other side of the fence of business, on the regulatory side, on deciding public policies. But it turns out to be a very exhilarating experience. And I learned a lot, just like a freshman student on business, from Pak Mochtar, from James, even from John Riady. Now, I don't think I would follow my friend George here commenting on the book itself, because what George has already talked much about the book, so very interesting. I read it in Indonesian. The book in Indonesia, I think it's almost bestseller for that kind of book. And university students, managers, would-be aspiring business people, even people in governments are reading the book and try to learn from Pak Mochtar's experience. Being so long in the government, I'm not as familiar with Pak Mochtar as I want to be. You know, I regret it, I didn't know too much about any of them, but what I knew about Pak Mochtar when I was still a young member of the Indonesian cabinet was a success for a businessman who is a builder of empire. He built the best, the biggest, the most successful bank in Indonesia, and then he left it. He built another successful bank in Indonesia and he left it. So he is a builder. He is a builder of corporations. He built something that we have never heard of, a network of hospitals in a country where public health has always been seen as the responsibility of the government. Now, I think in a few more years, in the network, the hospitals that are organized by the Lippo Group will be much larger than the government's own network. So, Pak Mochtar is a builder. Pak Mochtar is a trailblazer. Because, you know, reading his book and talking with him, learning a lot from him, he actually seems to be bored with old things, things that have become normative. He always tried to find new ones. One day I asked Pak Mochtar, "Pak, you build banks, big banks. Now you had bank, you have a bank, Bank Nobu. Why aren't you making it as another big bank?" He said, "No, this is a different time." So he has another design for Bank Nobu. not following the other steps. Maybe he can later inform us what he thinks about Magna Book. And basically, it is more related to digital. In fact, he has his heart now more in digital things, more in disruptive technology. He established research on nanotechnology, trying to cure cancer. There is a hospital in Jakarta named Mochtar Riady Center, Cancer Center, MRCC. So that is Pak Mochtar that, you know, from the outside, not part of the family that I've been seeing. Another thing, well, he is a giant in our business community. He's an icon. He's the most successful businessman, not only in Indonesia, in Asia, as mentioned by George, maybe. But he is also a philanthropist from his heart, not because if it is a CSR. So one day I was invited to join Pak Mochtar to go to Papua, Pak Mochtar and Ibu Mochtar. In the middle of nowhere, we went to a place where even the government doesn't know that it exists. I have to tell you that very frankly. You know, when we spoke with the government, where are you going? We're going to a place called Deboto. Where is it? Well, he was asking his staff, where is it? So the group is already there, but not the group as a business community, but they have their small clinics, a school to be established, and the nurses were there. They were graduates from the nurse college, and they asked, why are you here? Because they're the only outsiders. The others are Papuans who still live in the last century or two, you know, the way they clothed, for instance. And they said it is a calling of God. The girl told me, who was, I choose this. I had the choice to choose others. So that's the atmosphere that is being developed in this group that was developed by Pak Mochtar. I'm a Muslim. Well, I hope I'm a good Muslim. I hope I try to, but I respect Pak Mochtar for, although he has good Christians, his family is good Christians, but in a way that doesn't create, gets and threaten the majority of Muslim in Indonesia. Of course, some people are trying to see, well, they are Christian, they are evangelical. I don't think so. I'm not. I think they're very, very much like us. We call us pre-Bumi and Muslim in Indonesia. And another thing that I would like to share with you, because most of the things you can read in the books and more sophisticated things will probably be elaborated further by my colleagues there. Behind a successful man, there is a woman. So we know Ibu Mochtar is beside him. But most successful people could be or should be judged from the offsprings. So Pak Mochtar had children who are really very, very successful. And they are one. I think I think Pak Mochtar always says, well, my sons, they're better than me. And my grandsons, they're better than my sons. Yeah. That's what she said. I'm not sure about that. The problem is, well, the offspring, you know, that's where it all come from. That's another thing. And he told us at the time, well, Jim was too harsh on his children. John and his son and his brother were forced to go to Papua, live in that kind of village in Papua for a week or two. Just imagine. So Pak Mochtar was complaining that James is too hard on his sons. But his son still was complaining. You know, at the time when there was this little problem, you know, it's a Chinese problem, you know, there was a time in our history, very dark time, but it was history. And Pak Mochtar sent James to study abroad, of course. You know where? To Macau, of all places. Not, why not to Hong Kong or to, you know, it went well, but he sent him to Macau. I could imagine Macau in the time must be like that. So Pak Mochtar himself is very, very, very tough on his children. And I think, I told my son, my children, well, look at them. You have to be tough, you have to love your children, groom them, but still you have to be tough with them. Well, I don't know whether what else I can share with you, but I really hope Mochtar really as successful in Indonesian as a statesman. The statesmen do not necessarily come from the public service, from the private sector also. We respect you. We are very proud of you. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Professor Ginaja.
Well, I need to introduce the next speaker. Sorry, the next speaker will be Dr. Halimah Yaakob, Speaker of the Singapore Parliament. Formerly, Dr. Halimah was Minister of State for Community Development and Youth, and she was very much concerned. She is very much concerned about women issue, youth issue, and radical Islamism, which I also very much concerned. And it is a pity, I think, that there are people who committed violence in the name of God and the name of Islam. I think we share that. Yeah. And Ibu Dr. Halimah is the ninth speaker in the Singapore Parliament, the first woman. Well, we in Indonesia, we had a woman president, but we don't have yet a woman speaker of parliament. So let me introduce Dr. Halimah Yaakob.
Terima kasih, Pak. Pak Mochtar Riady, Ibu Mochtar, family members, and friends. Actually, the previous two speakers have said so much already. Covered everything, actually. But so what I will do is just to lend my voice to the book. I don't think I'll be able to do justice to the book, but let me just lend my voice to the book that is being launched today on Pak Mochtar Riady's life, and to say that it is really a fascinating read. There's so many different lessons that you can learn, and it's really, truly wonderful, and I really want to commend you to make an effort to read the book. And let me begin my speech by quoting what President Joko Widodo of Indonesia said about this book. And he said, "Hopefully, this book can inspire the younger generation to be more courageous, not to be complacent, but to compete, struggle, and fight for their beliefs. Don't let there be a spoon-fed generation. Pak Mochtar is a great inspiration for our generation." Indeed, I think that's a most apt comment on the part of the president, because you know, Pak Mochtar built an empire out of practically nothing. So that's truly an amazing story and a great inspiration for the younger generation. Indeed, the quote holds true for our younger generation of Singaporeans as well, because the lessons and values that Pak Mochtar espouses in his book are so universal and timeless. Pak Mochtar's life reflects that it is not so important what you are born with and what you lose, but what you do with the opportunities that you are given and how you deal with the challenges that come your way. And I have learned this in my own personal life as well. If you were to read his book, you will know there were many instances. It was not plain sailing that he's able to build most competitive and such a business empire. There were also failures along the way, but he took it in his stride, and he's able to overcome, and you know, he's able to show and he's able to have his imprint in practically so many different sectors of the economy. Pak Mochtar's book, covering 8 decades of his life and divided into 20-year periods, traces the hardship and suffering of his early years. The launching of his business that grew together with the newly independent Indonesia, the progress of an outward-looking business amid the sweeping tide of globalization, and finally, the global adjustments needed in the face of China's rise. Weaving through these periods, he narrates how he was born in Indonesia and how he left for China, where he had his studies, and how his true love for his girlfriend, now of course his wife, brought him back to Indonesia, and then how he began to establish his own businesses and successfully embarked on his ambition to be a good banker. So in his book, he said The question is, should he be a successful banker or a good banker? He chooses to be a good banker. There's a difference between being just successful. You may be successful, but you may not necessarily be good. But he chooses to be a good banker who's also successful. That is, again, a reflection of the values that he holds. It is a book that all young enterprising businessmen should read to appreciate the many useful lessons that the author had learned throughout life to arrive at where he is today. Pak Mukhtar's story is reflective of how the pioneer generation of people had helped to build their respective countries with their imagination, hard work, resilience, determination, and a deep sense of responsibility and duty to one's family and nation. Just like Singapore's founding fathers developed a tiny island with no natural resources into an international metropolis, Pak Mukhtar, with his imaginative, innovative, and indomitable spirit, has built the Lippo Group into a global conglomerate of diversified businesses, which includes banking, real estate, hospitality, F&B, and some are also listed on the Singapore Exchange. He built all this out of nothing. Current and future generations of Singaporeans would do well to imbibe these priceless values to give them the necessary ballast to not just stay afloat, but thrive, especially in an increasingly volatile, disruptive, and uncertain world. Even as Singaporeans leave their homes to pursue opportunities in a faraway land in this globalized world, they must not forget the words that Pak Mukhtar's grandmother told him when he left her. And she said, "You must go away in order to come back." And like Pak Mukhtar, they must remember the principle that Pak Mukhtar shared: when drinking water, think of the source. I cannot think of more apt words to describe the values we want to impart to our young, who are mobile, they're global citizens, but to really cite these two statements. Even if they are not physically in the country, they should remember to contribute to Singapore society, just like Pak Mukhtar is doing in Indonesia, where he's taking schools and hospitals to the remoter parts of the country. He has also remembered to contribute to China, the land where he spent part of his childhood in, as well as in Singapore, where he has undertaken many philanthropic endeavors, such as funding scholarship programs at the NUS Business School and the Singapore Management University. But Mukhtar's life shows the importance of families as an important pillar of support for the nation. In particular, the importance of dedicated parents who take the time and effort to impart the right values to their children, to raise their children to be socially responsible individuals, even as their spouses have passed on, as in Pak Mukhtar's case, when Pak Mukhtar's father, the father's grandmother passed away during childbirth. The wife passed away during childbirth. But I also remember there's one example in the book when I think, Pak Mukhtar, you were a little bit excited over some gambling, and your father discovered and he told you to stop it. He said that you do not become rich by gambling, but you become rich by really working very hard for it. But even that, he really took that as a learning point. And later, when he had his bank, he decided to encourage people to save. He told them that if you put in your money, then you can take part in some, schemes where they can then win a prize like a car and some other benefits. And that scheme apparently did much better than even the Indonesian government scheme at getting people to save money. So I think, the interesting thing that I find about Pak Mukhtar is that he really learns every time, all the time. There are lessons that life teaches him. He takes those lessons and then he translates that, uses that in his business, in his relationships, and so on. So that, I think, is really, really very insightful. It shows a person that believes truly in lifelong learning. And it also shows the importance of having committed and supportive marriages where spouses mutually stand by each other through thick and thin. Let me conclude with a quote that the late Mr. S.R. Navan, a former president of Singapore, had penned before he passed away. And he said, "Dr. Riady has many stories and life lessons to reflect on. But at 87 years old, he's still a man, excited about what is to come and always looking into the future." I think that's the important thing, to continue to be excited about life, to learn new things and to apply them for the good of society. And so I think that's the most important thing about Pak Riady. We should all learn from Pak Mochtar Riady and be inquisitive lifelong learners to seek and understand the unpredictable nature of the economy and prepare for disruptive global changes, particularly the digital technological revolution, which has already transformed the way that we live and work. Instead of fearing the changes, we must learn to embrace them. So what did I take away from the book personally? Many, many things. One, I learned that, Pak Mochtar, your values are universal. Yes, we all know you're deeply committed to the religion, your faith, but your commitment to your faith is not something that is exclusive. It's in fact inclusive. It includes you embrace society, the community, through your various contributions. In that sense, therefore, those values are used in order to help the community, to help society. So it is not something that is exclusionary, but it is inclusive. What can we learn from Pak Mochtar, which I learned, is that the values of hard work, discipline, self-reliance, those are really invaluable. What else do we learn from Pak Mochtar's book personally? It is the love for the family, tremendous love, I think, for his wife, Li Mei, tremendous love for his children, grandchildren, and that continues. And he said that now there are 98 members of your family. Pak Mochtar, it's going to be 100 soon.
Yes. By next year, yes.
Yeah, so I think that's something which Singaporeans must also learn. how to continue to increase and multiply. And that's something that we must also, take a leaf from the book, of Pak Mochtar's book, you know, very important. So many lessons, and what is also interesting is how, as I think George mentioned, at every opportunity there are learning points and that he picks up. And he tells us, you know, like he took over a bank, which is true. I also read that part and I was a little bit quite amazed that he actually goes down to the storeroom and sorts out the boxes, you know, tells people how to sort out the boxes because it's very messy. So he decided that it's important for him to do that. Nothing is too low, too little, too trivial for him to, in order to make sure that he does his work well. So I think that is the remarkable thing. So Pak Mochtar, I want to say congratulations for your book. I commend everyone here to read it. I think there's so many gems in the book, and I'm sure that the younger generation will greatly benefit from those gems that are found in your book. Congratulations. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Halima Yaakob, for those very warm and kind words. And before we hear from the man himself, let's take a moment now to enjoy a brief commentary on Dr. Riady's life.
Dr. Mochtar Riady, most widely recognized as the founder of conglomerate Lippo Group, is a man who's devoted his life to building businesses and serving communities in and beyond Indonesia. Dr. Riady was born on May 12, 1929 in Malang, East Java. He earned his degree at National Central University, now known as Southeast University in Nanjing, China. In 1954, Dr. Riady moved to Jakarta. Despite humble beginnings, his career rose in stellar fashion. As a banker, Dr. Riady is known as a specialist in restoring ailing banks. Between 1960 and 1971,
he helped turn several debt-ridden local banks profitable. He then created Pannon Bank by orchestrating the historic merger of four banks, making it the largest private lender in the country. In 1975, Dr. Riady revitalized Bank Central Asia into the second clearing bank in Indonesia. Following his success with BCA, Dr. Riady established his own bank, the Lippo Bank. His rare ability to find opportunities during times of crisis has allowed Lippo Group to diversify and expand beyond financial services. Lippo is now a major player in real estate, telecommunications, retail, healthcare, education, media, and technology. Apart from Indonesia, Lippo has businesses in Singapore, Hong Kong, China, and the United States, and employs about 115,000 people globally. Dr. Riady has always believed in the transformative power of education. Besides establishing the Pelita Harapan Schools and the Pelita Harapan University, he also set up schools in several rural areas in eastern Indonesia, such as Papua, where he founded the Lentera Harapan School. He also serves on the boards of universities all around the world. A passionate academic, Dr. Riady was awarded honorary doctorates by universities in China and the U.S. He's a significant benefactor of many leading universities in Asia. The business school building in the National University of Singapore bears his name. And he recently donated to Tsinghua University a 15,000 square meter library that can hold over 600,000 books. In recognition for his service to Indonesia, the government awarded Dr. Riady with a Lifetime Achievement Award in 2015. In the same year, Dr. Riady was also awarded the Lifetime Achievement Award by the Indonesia Property Watch. Dr. Riady's vision for business has always been one of stewardship. And it's with this same vision that he penned this book, looking toward the future with the hope that the enterprise he built will continue to contribute towards a better tomorrow for Southeast Asia.
Ladies and gentlemen, the moment we've been waiting for all afternoon to hear personally from the man of the hour. It's with great pleasure that I invite Dr. Mochtar Riady and the Dean of the NUS Business School and Stephen Riady Distinguished Professor, Professor Bernard Yong, to have a conversation. Now, this session will be conducted in Mandarin, so if you like a Mandarin to English translation, it can be found on your headset on Channel 1. And now, may I invite Dr. Riady and Professor Yong, please.
Thank you. Pak Riady, distinguished panelists, and the Riady family, and ladies and gentlemen. I'm going to transit, moving from English into Mandarin, so that you have time to put on your earphone. It really is an honor to be here, to have a dialogue with you, Pak Riady. You are a legend. Already, your current president has been quoted. So I quote your former president, Mr. Habibi. He never forgot the importance of being good and not merely successful. If future generation of Indonesians will read this book and find an example to emulate, I am as hopeful as Pak Mochtar that Indonesia has a bright future ahead. Wonderful. And my president is here, so I quote my president, Teng Chua Chuan. Dr. Riady's biography offers many inspiring life lessons that we can all draw upon on our journeys. 我觉得真的很荣幸有机会再见你，问你一些问题，求你心上再加强我们的学习。谢谢您。我觉得是很感动的是，你生育幼晚，在一个很贫困、很战火连连的年代，白手兴家，创造了很伟大的事业。 就我们从前新加坡的President讲起说， today, the Lippo Group is one of Asia's largest business group, the partners of choice of many blue chip foreign investors. 刚才的document已经看到很多很多，但是我觉得 不只是这样子，我是觉得你做了，应该是24家医院会变成35家，有3家大学，57家的中小学，全都加起来，其实你在这个环境，从刚开始在莆田到现在，你是给我们做了很多很多祝福了，这个社会。 造福人群，我觉得看到你的传记，让我想到什么叫修心齐家治国平天下。我谢谢你。<笑>我觉得没有人是由你更能够体会到你自己的成长、你自己的生命、你自己的理念。我看你书。 有一段，一开始是你写的诗，我很感动。我有英语版，没有中文版。它你的标题是 Harmony， 我扩一下 ，Harmony is reflected in the reality of disharmony. All things exist relative to each other, and they develop into relation to each other. Combine the disparates. Into the unified, interacting and enriching each other at the same time, collaborate over the same goal. And hold, you conclude. This is the meaning of harmonious management. 我觉得这个真是很精彩。他把它让我感觉到你说的修心是什么，你的理念是什么。所以我想问你一个问题，在你的成长。 有很多困难，中间也一定有很多挫折。刚才其他 panelists 有讲到，可以跟我们分享一下你这个理念是怎么成长出来，是怎么从困难或者是不困难，还怎么从老师、家人怎么从世界上成立了这个那么重要的做人的、做生意的大道理呢？可以跟我们分享一下吗？好。
Actually, your question all answered by these three. I would like to thank you very much. And it is a good opportunity to me to take this opportunity to speak in Mandarin. Yes.
好，谢谢，谢谢。<笑>
你的汉语会讲的比我好。不会，不会，还是你好。<笑>我想我要讲的是，我很幸运，我有个好父亲。我从我父亲身上看到一个做儿子的责任。 当我的祖父病的时候，他带了全家回到中国，这个福建莆田去看病。不久以后，我祖父过世，我父亲把我母亲跟我呢留在家里陪伴我的祖母。这个就是我父亲，这个是吧，做儿子的责任。 有一个时候，我问我父亲：“爸爸，你是四个兄弟，为什么老是你去负责这些东西？为什么你弟弟不去做这些，叔叔们不去做这些东西？”他说：“因为他是哥哥，所以他要负起这个责任。”所以这是我父亲表现出做兄弟的责任。 我母亲过世的时候，我才8岁，我父亲才40岁。从那个时候开始呢，他没有再结婚。他每天早上起来烧香念经，纪念我的母亲。十几年以来，他永远是这样。这是表现说。 我父亲呢，做丈夫的责任是怎么样子？那么，他每天早上叫我起来，要我去学校。我从学校回家以后，他总是查我的看我的书包，叫我写字，叫我这个念书。 同时用连环图画叫我读《三国演义》。到了我懂得《三国演义》以后呢，他给我读正本的《三国演义》。所以呢，这个就是我父亲对儿子的责任。我父亲非常仔细地观察 我的一些小动作，我买彩票，他知道了，警告我不可以买彩票。<笑>啊、发财一定要靠流汗去挣，去发财，并不是靠阴气去发财。
嗯。
那么，<咳>我父亲也经常讲起说，一个家庭兴旺。 靠家教，一个公司发达，要靠有知识的这个人才；一个民族、一个国家要强盛，要靠教育的普遍。这是我从我父亲那边看到的、学习到的一些东西。那么我祖父呢？ 在村子里面呢，他可以算是第二富的这个财主。在八九十年以前呢，在乡下没有学校，所以我祖父呢请了老师到家里来，开了一个叫私塾。他每天到所有的乡村里面。 让孩子到我家里去念书，我也从我祖父那边看到这一个问题，就是说教育的重要性。
嗯，
啊，那么当然，从这里面呢，我学到了我们做人的道理应该是怎么样子的。我想这应该是我分享给我的 下一代的人知道说做父亲是怎么样、什么责任，做这个丈夫什么责任啊，做一个公民是什么责任？
嗯，
哎，我想这个呢是非常重要的，对我的成功有莫大的关系。那么刚才几位先生也讲过，我有个很好的妻子。 最重要的就是，当我成为Bank Buana的 CEO 的时候，有一天，一个客户啊送了我10块金条，我感到非常的高兴。我拿回去了以后呢，我以为说我太太一定很喜欢，想不到她起先以为我是买的，她说我们银根很紧，刚刚做事，你干嘛的去买？ 这四条金块，我说不是的，这是人家送给我的。他说为什么人家要送给你？你接受了人家的金条，等于你是卖身给这个人，以后你要受他的控制，这是非常不智、非常危险的事情。我从这里面呢，我感觉到说，我太太是一个很了不起的人。 中国人讲说，成功的一个男人后面必定有一个好的前妻。我觉得说这句话非常重要啊。所以呢，我的孩子们、我的孙子们、 我的太太审批了以后才可以。 我想说，我今天我这个家族能够有一点小成就，能够大家合在一起，再共同奋斗嘛，这应该是我有一个很好的妻子，她的功劳，不是我的功劳。 我也很高兴，我的孩子们都比我强。那么刚才大家讲到我在印尼这个开这个几十间的学校，这一点呢，实际上呢，我要讲的不是我的功劳，是 Jim Riady 的功劳，啊，同时的是他的妻子。 Eileen Riady 的功劳，他们一直在发展这些东西。那么，比如说，我在捐送给这个 NUS 的这个大厦总所呢，跟厦门大学的大厦、清华大学的这个图书馆总所，这不是我的钱，这是我的儿子 Stephen Riady 的钱。 大家都以为说我很富，其实我很穷，富的是我的孩子，不是我。但是我很幸福，这些孩子们啊，都很听我的话。虽然钱不是我的，但我可以告诉他你怎么用，他们很听话。这个大概。 我可以分享的就是这些东西。那么主要的我这本书呢，我是告诉是，一个人一定有身份，这个身份是随着年龄增加而增加。那么，可是每一个身份的后面呢，必定有一个责任，特别是社会责任。假如说今天一个人。 只懂得身份，而不懂得身份后面应该尽的一个责任，那么这个人呢，就是对社会有害处，啊。刚才我们的国会议长讲的，我在做的时候呢，做银行的时候呢，我一直在自己问自己，我要做一个 good banker or the success banker。 That is two different things. The success banker, no matter how to use the money, the credit, I don't care. As long as you can pay higher interest, and then you can provide the strong collateral, I will provide it. 可是一个好的银行家呢？ 他要注意到是每一分钱拿出去，都得要对社会有利益的，能够增加就业，能够增加税收，那么每一天在想如何减轻我们客户的负担，这是我们做一个好银行家的一个精神。所以这些东西呢，应该讲的都是。 我父亲给我的一个影响，我今天要这本书要主要传达的，就是告诉我的下一代，要懂得责任，要懂得身份背后的责任，那么对，特别是社会的责任。我们今天我是印尼共和国的这个公民，我要尽我的责任。 替我的祖国呢，尽一些责任，来这个发展这个教育的事业，发展这个医疗的事业，使得对我们的社会有贡献。谢谢你。
肯，谢谢。 其实我还有好多问题想问，我减少一点点，我想问另外一个问题，可以吗？
可以吗？有时间吗？
Yeah. 因为我是觉得，我觉得我们从前的那任总统， 就是我们的 speaker 已经讲过， 虽然你是87岁， still a man excited about what is to come and always looking to the future. 我们现在一天就在想， 现在我们所谓的 fourth industrial revolution, material science, digitalization, the rise of China, and 整个我觉得是有我们兴奋的东西， 但是有我们紧张的东西。 你的看法是怎么样呢？ 我们应该心态是怎么样？ 我们年轻这一代应该怎么去面对这个将来？ 还有就是， 从你的眼光来说， 未来87年， 你会做什么再创奇迹？ 用这个机遇。
谢谢。 中国人有一句话说， 富不过三代。 我年轻的时候， 看到马朗， 苏拉巴亚， 加加达， 有很多有钱的人， 但是现在呢， 他的家族呢， 已经不知道他们在什么地方。 所以这是富不过三代。 而在1980年代， 市面上有很多的书 关于日本的事情。 我曾经看过三本书， 第一本书是 Japan Can Say No， 第二本书是 Japan No. 1， 第三本书是 Sony Management Style。 这三本书呢， 都在叙述关于日本这个民族是非常了不起的。 我也同意说日本人在这方面非常成功。 但是在过去这个5个月里面呢， Panasonic, Sharp, Hitachi, 还有一家什么公司呢， 那么被中国的企业收过去的。 三五年以前呢， 日本的一个汽车工业就是尼桑汽车工业， 被法国的汽车工业买去了。 最后这个尼桑工业又买了米其比西汽车工业。 所以呢， 这一点呢， 我相信我们大家都必须要深深地在讨论这个研究这个问题。 为什么在80年代 那么强盛的这个企业呢， 但是今天呢， 他们有面临困难。 那么是不是企业也是富不过三代？ 这是一个很严肃的问题， 应该值得每一个人都去审视这个东西。 在我的看法呢， 这些企业没有办法维持长远生存， 应该就是像你刚才讲的， 因为他不了解现在我们面临这个叫做 Industrial Revolution 4.0。 什么叫做工业第四代的革命呢？ 主要的就是因为这个信息科技， 主要的是因为纳米科技， 主要的是因为生物科技。 我们知道从这个纳米科技这个引发到这个什么信息科技， 那么这所有的这些东西呢， 今天呢把我们的企业都带到了一个这个叫做数码这个经济， Digital Economy。 那么因为世界现在经济发展了， 许多的国家包括我们印度尼西亚， 我们的middle class 这个 society 已经是形成了。所以呢，市面上很需要这些服务为主的行业。那么这些企业呢，不论是什么行业里面，都跟这个数码科技有关系。前几天 有一家印尼的报馆请我去演讲，讲完了以后呢，有一个 audience 问我，他说：“李先，你认为这个 textile industry is a sunset industry？” And my answer is no. 因为衣服这个纺织品呢，是永远人家所需要的。 我问他说：“你是不是有一天想不穿衣服？”假如你没有想说不穿衣服，所以这个 textile 工业呢，纺织业呢，永远不是叫做夕阳工业。但是你的工业呢，你的工厂呢，要是不这个 design 不按照这个叫做什么这个用这个ID去做一个 design，
跟不住社会的脚步啊！你的生产不用这个最新式的这个
ID，你的 marketing 不通过这个 e-commerce 来做的话呢，你的 administration 没有通过这个 information technology 的时候呢，你的工厂就会变成 sunset industry。那么我讲这些东西呢，总结的一句话就是说，我很希望说我的下一代们。 都要懂得，一直要随时随地要注意到世界上对于科技的革命，啊，譬如说今天大家讲到这个手机，那么过去这个手机呢，它里面它这个 chip 呢芯片呢是用这个silicon 去做的，但是现在。 在中国华为公司的实验室里面呢，他已经用了 graphene 什么硒去取代这个东西。那么这个是一个大革命。除了这个以外呢，中国在前一个月呢发射了一颗卫星，叫做 quantum satellite。那么这个 quantum satellite 呢，什么就是 quantum 呢？就是粒子呢比 分也比原子的分子还要小，除此它的这个敏感性也非常强，所以是将来呢，这个所有信息的 BDS 呢，可能全部要改变了。诸如这一类的改变呢，会影响到整个经济的改变。假如要是我们对这些的改变没有注意的话呢？ 那么我们的企业就变作是夕阳企业，我们的家族就变作是夕阳家族，这个是我最怕的，这个是我要永远告诉我的孩子的。那么像刚才我的孙子讲，我每天在看书，主要的在什么？我要告诉他，我不比他输。<笑><笑>主要的是要告诉他，我吃的没有这个 generation gap。 这样子呢，我跟我的孙子们呢，就可以很好的沟通，就可以保持我们家族的这个青春，恒古不息。谢谢。
你 Pariadi， 你真是往前看的人，是今天我才跟少将在讨论。 我们对现在一个改变的紧张，但是你给我们解答了。从前学的东西不可靠，一直要往前走，一直要看到，注意改变，还要更想改变，还要创作改变。谢谢你的 advice， 谢谢。我想你的员工说已经差不多时间了，是吗？所以我就没有办法再问问题，但是可以允许我问一个很简单的问题吗？
还有个问题，
很简单，<笑>我想问你。 你希望100年之后，大家怎么 remember Pariadi？ How do you want people to remember you？
这点我还没想到。我就希望想说，我的孙子能够想到我就好了。谢谢。
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. It's a great dialogue, and I learned so much. Thank you, thank you. And let me pass this back
thank
to
you. Thank you, Dr. Mochtar Riady, and thank you, Professor Yong, for a very warm and generous sharing. And last but not least, we would like to invite now the Dean of the Lee Kuan Yew School of Public Policy, Professor Kishore Mahbubani, who also wrote the foreword to the book, to say a few words. Professor, please.
Thank you. Madam Halima Yaakob, Pa Mokhtar, Ibu Mokhtar, distinguished guests. You know, we were chatting in the room outside, Pa Mokhtar and I. And I said to him, you know, I've published 5 books. When I have a book launch, 50 people come. You publish 1 book, 1,000 people come. Obviously, this is quite an amazing event. It's been a real honor to be asked to write the foreword for the book, an equally great honor to try and summarize what you've heard here. It'll be difficult because you had lots of wisdom, but let me leave you perhaps with 3 key words you could take away from our discussions about the book. The first key word is Asia. And I'm sure you're all aware, even as you look around this room and feel the mood in this room, there's a clear sense of confidence about the future. That in one way or another, Asia will be better off 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, 20 years from now. But trust me, if you had the same book launch in Europe today, you had the same book launch even in America today, you wouldn't have this kind of sense of confidence about the future. In Europe, you have Brexit. In America, you have Donald Trump. And that alone explains how remarkably different we are. But the big question is, why are we different? And I think one simple answer is that the people of Pap Mokhtar's generation, and by the way, if you read the book, you get a very vivid sense of how difficult life was in his youth, the conflict, the uncertainty, you know, the sense of desperation, hopelessness. And coming from that, you've had this amazing success. And if people like Pap Mokhtar had given up at that time, Asia wouldn't be where it is today. So my first point is, let's thank Pap Mokhtar for contributing to the rise of Asia. The second key word is Indonesia. And it's actually quite remarkable. Trust me, you know, as one who's been an analyst for several decades, if you had asked people 30 years ago, 20 years ago, do you see Indonesia emerging as one of the most successful countries in the world? And everybody would have said, no, it won't happen. And now it's amazing. People around the world, as they look for countries to bet on, countries to where they believe that the future is going to be great, they turn to Indonesia. And George was absolutely right when he spoke about Pelita Harapan. And that's remarkable about Indonesia. It is one of the most optimistic countries in the world. Again, why? It's the contribution of people of Pap Mokhtar's generation and his genuine commitment to Indonesia and his philanthropy. So another round of applause for what you've done for Indonesia. My last keyword is future. And let me begin with a personal confession. I'm about 20 years younger than Pap Mokhtar. I'm 67 years old. I've already noticed at 67, this is off the record, I'm slowing down. I no longer run as fast as I used to. I can't do as much as I used to, you know. So you can feel your energy levels going down. And then I look at Pap Mokhtar. At 87, he's focused on the future. He's talking about biotechnology, nanotechnology, digital technology. And he's focused on what is coming. And that's a remarkable thing. You know, people at his age should be celebrating what they have achieved. Instead, he's not looking backwards, he's looking forwards. And as you all know, as you could tell from the eloquent commentaries today, he's taking his entire family with him into the future. So I'm sure you all agree that we've been very privileged to participate in this occasion, to join in this book launch. And I'm sure you want to all join me for one final round of applause to him for writing a book at 87. Thank you.
Thank you for a very, very wonderful summary of the event, Prof. Kishore. And at this point now, it will be the Dr. Riady will now give away the first copies of his English language autobiography, beginning with our guests here on stage. Dr. Riady, please, if you may rise. And Dr. Riady, would you like to present the first copy to Dr. Halima? Thank you. And the next copy to Professor Dr. Gnanja. Thank you. To Professor Dr. Gnanja. And to Mr. Giorgio. To Prof. Kishore. And last but not least, to Professor Young. And perhaps we can huddle together for a family photo. Thank you, and a warm round of applause for all our wonderful guests this afternoon. May I invite our guests to take their seats back at the table, and Dr. Riady, can I request that you stay on stage?
Please remain. My grandfather said he listens to my orders. Well, once again, I think, ladies and gentlemen, I think this concludes our event this evening. I think on behalf of my grandfather, Pap Mokhtar Riady, as well as our family, I'd like to once again say thank you to our guest of honor, Dr. Halima Yaqub, as well as our panel of distinguished speakers for their very kind words. Can we give a round of applause for our panelists? I'd also like to express our gratitude for all of the guests here today for joining this very momentous occasion for my grandfather. At the conclusion of this event, my grandfather is going to be remaining on stage to sign copies of his book. And so for those of you who would like to have an autographed copy of my grandfather's autobiography, please feel free to line up to the front of the stage.
Oh,
Don't all come at once, though. single cue, please. And then on your way out of this ballroom, you'll also be receiving a gift bag, which includes some traditional cakes from my grandfather's hometown in Indonesia, in Malang, as well as some tea from Fujian province in China. Finally, I'd like to express our gratitude to all of those who were involved in making, in materializing my grandfather's autobiography, as well as all those who were involved in planning this event, particularly the staff of Mandarin Orchard Singapore. So thank you, good evening, and God bless you all.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, and now we've come to the end of the launch of My Life Story. Thank you for taking time to join us. For those who'd like a signed copy, please make your way forward. Please remember to leave the headsets on the table. Thank you once again for joining us. Have a great evening.